CONTINENTEX211, educating the youths through films.
Dr.John Garang the Mabior, Chairman of SBLM and Commander-in-Chief of the SBLA, on behalf of the New Sudan community in the United Kingdom and Northern Ireland, we welcome you and your delegation. We also wish to seize this opportunity to congratulate you and Dr. John and Dr. Riak Machar for having signed an agreement for unity. Unity between the two of you and among our people. Majority of our people believe that unity is the only way forward. It has been the only way forward and is still the only way forward and will remain the only way forward. In this struggle, as well as the only way of achieving the national liberation and a just and lasting peace. Thank you.
Yes, may I invite Anito now to give her a presentation? Yes.
Chairman of SPLM and Commander-in-Chief of SPLA, Dr.John Garang de Mabior, and his delegation, distinguished guests, friends of the Sudanese people, the Sudanese living in UK, ladies and gentlemen, I feel very honored to be with you at the matter of this very important occasion. I would like to inform you that I may be the only lady with the gentleman here, but I bring along greetings and love from the Sudanese people, especially children and women. They ask me to remind you that war or conflict is like a snake that enters into your house. What people normally do in the first instance is to take cover or run away for security. But nobody leaves their home for a snake. They normally go grab a stick and come and beat and kill the snake, throw it out and come to live comfortably with them. I would like to tell you, this is their message, that you still have responsibility towards them. That they expect you to come and take a stick. And this stick may be advocacy. This stick may be education, which we in the Sudan are fighting for. Education for girls first and for everybody. Your stick could be investment. Your stick could be contribution towards building the machinery that is required to make the new Sudan. Because it will never happen alone. Once the enemy and the oppressor is not there, you have to complete the objective. Justice, peace, and liberation for all. And that requires all of us. In 5 minutes, I can't say all that I would have loved to, but I have a list of things that if anybody has time to come and pick up, that we are promoting, particularly for the communities, for the civil society, and for the women who are central to the liberation struggle. We are central to the Sudanese society, whether in time of peace or in time of war. We take care of the children, we produce food, we are forced to provide shelter and security, and when we go to our farms, we meet landmines, we are bombed, we are shot using helicopter gunship. If you have been listening to news, unfortunately I don't have pictures now, you would have heard of the suffering, the drowning of pregnant women in the river as they are being chased by the thoughtless, heartless regime. SPLM has come a long way. It has provided political space for women to develop, but we also have a long way to go. Women cannot do it alone. In our liberation struggle, we have to go hand in hand, helping each other and never losing the way. Thank you very much.
Dr. John Garang de Mabior, Chairman of SPLM, SPLA, ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to be with you today in this great hall. And participate in the discussion on the future of our country. But first of all, before I get to it, I would like to congratulate you, particularly those whose heart has been expressed by our elder, Gordon Mortat, expression he made on unity. I'm here to assure you that when we sign the January 6th declaration on unity between the two movements, I'm here to assure you that this is a fact, this is what we have longed for, and if there is somebody who has been doubting, Please let him take it that the liberation struggle has united. Like any other people who had struggled for freedom and justice, there are always bound to be differences. And they could be deep, they could be profound, but they are also subtle. I believe that this was what happened in 1991, when there were differences on conceptualization, on the objective of the struggle, and also on issues such as democracy, human rights. I want to assure you that we have agreed to forget and forgive. I said we have agreed to forget the past and start a new chapter. And in this, we hope peace shall come to our country soon. And let me talk a little bit about peace. You know, in 1997, we attempted to make peace with the present regime. But those who were in Sudan and anybody who has been following has also noted that the present regime is not serious about bringing about a peaceful settlement to the conflict in the Sudan. In that 1997, we had concentrated on one single issue, the issue of self-determination to the people of Southern Sudan. Because we looked at it, that the conflict is basically southern. And if the people of Southern Sudan acceded the right to exercise self-determination, then the war in the whole Sudan would end. I still believe that this is the issue. But does the regime in Khartoum see it that way? No, it doesn't. Although, when the regime came to power, it floated the idea that if the South wants exercise of self-determination, they would be ready. We have tested the regime, we feel it did not honor its side of the agreement. Not because self-determination is a difficult issue. Even if the process we signed with the present regime, if it did not contain self-determination, I think the regime would have still dishonored it. Because the Sudan has other issues on which the war is fought today. Democracy. Our country lacked democracy. Despite the trust we made so that the country goes to democracy before exercise of any self-determination, the regime even resisted. We know its record. We know its record of terrorism not only in the South, but also in the North. We know its record of trying to Islamize the whole country, even those who are Muslims, if their brand is different. The regime wants to see that it takes its Islamic thought, even if you are Muslim. So in Sudan, we have these problems. What should we do? Is that regime qualified to bring peace in the country? Not because I differed with them, But I answered, I said, it's not qualified. It cannot honor its agreements. It cannot stomach the idea of democratization happening in the country. It's bent to rule the country single-handedly. But today we see that there are some overshoots that some countries are also dealing with, on the basis that it is cooperating on the international terrorism aspect. But are the issues of Sudan only international terrorism? We have the war in the south, now has engulfed the whole country. There is lack of democracy. The people are being displaced from their own locations because the regime wants to exploit oil. So what do we do? My answer is, the regime must go. It's non-negotiating that will make a change. We have tried. In that agreement, if it were serious, peace would have come. But it is not serious. But we have a big task to do. The world sees the struggle is united. One reason which this regime could have used, the struggle is now united. Still, the world sees that it does not have an alternative. Can we not provide an alternative instead of trying to do the impossible of reforming the regime from inside? I believe we can do that. It only needs us to correctly identify the issues that make the Sudanese people disagree. One fundamental issue is the war in the South, is the political demand of the people of the South. The other fundamental issue is the restoration of democracy. Can we in the opposition provide an alternative? I believe we can do that. If we can reach a basic minimal program in all the opposition sector, not only in the SPLA, but also in the NDA. And this is the challenge today that we must discuss among ourselves, individuals, political groups, political movements, to come up with a viable alternative. And this, as I said before, is a necessity. It is not transforming the regime or making the regime transform itself into an alternative. We have tried. And I believe Sadiq al-Mahdi, with the 1 year he has gone in, he has tried. Therefore, today our challenge is, can we make that? Well, I throw it, it is a debate. And since I have made that point, I don't need to go ahead. Thank you very much.
Bye. Let me begin by greeting and thanking Elder Gordon Mortad for his revolutionary words, and greet all of you, elders, fellows, citizens, sisters, brothers, compatriots. I wish you all a happy new year. Although we are in March, we have Nehemaga Velnaya. I'm happy to see this, the faces here, which as I look from left to right and in depth, I see it as a reflection of what we have called the New Sudan. Because I'm seeing here people from everywhere in the Sudan, people from the south, people from the west, people from the center, people from the far north, people from the east. It's difficult to tell, like in Interbishu. Let me also greet and thank the friends of the Sudan who have come to attend this occasion. Elder Gordon Mortad's main emphasis was the issue of unity, which is very dear to our hearts. And we have started the year 2002 precisely with that. We have declared the year 2002 the year of reconciliation, peace, and unity. And my brother, Dr. Riek Machar, has just emphasized that, that we are committed to the peace, reconciliation, and unity that we have signed and that we have worked out. We have also, as some of you might have heard recently, also signed a unity accord with the Sudan Alliance Forces of Brother Abdulaziz Khalid. So the year 2002 is not only for unity in Southern Sudan and among Southern Sudanese, but it is the unity of all the people of the Sudan that have a case against what has happened in our country since 1956. And so I salute also that agreement that we reached with the brother Abdulaziz Khalid in Asmara 2 days ago. And on this basis of the coming together of the Sudanese in their struggle for a better future, I am hopeful and confident that this year 2002 will usher in a new era of a just peace that is based on achievement of full and total freedom, so that our long-suffering people engage in socio-economic development and achieve prosperity and stability in their lives. An era of peace, stability, development, and prosperity for all Sudanese. In planning this encounter with you, what should I call it, encounter? In planning this encounter with you, I had debated in my mind whether it should be a briefing on the situation in the country, whether it should be a lecture, whether it should be a dialogue. I decided to go for a combination of this. On all three, so as to give justice to this day. A briefing would be too shallow, as I would mainly be talking about the current political and military situation in the country, which is of course important, but would not give the depth to the important subject of the liberation struggle. A lecture, on the other hand, would become a monologue with me talking to you, which is not my intention. Finally, a dialogue, while it is most desirable, might not give sufficient background to the subject matter. For these reasons, I decided to have all three. And so let me begin my encounter with you with a lecture or a semi-lecture. I'll divide my presentation into six interrelated parts. One, I'll give a brief problem statement, its background and context. That may bore you because you know it, but bear with me. We have to give background to things. The second issue I will address is the response of the SPLM-SPLA to the problem that I will state, which is essentially talking about the objectives of the liberation struggle. The third issue I would want to cover is the New Sudan. The New Sudan as a vision and as a method of the liberation struggle. The fourth issue I would like to cover is the New Sudan again as a method for achieving peace and self-determination. The fifth area I would like to cover, I'll try to be quick, so don't be frightened by the list of the subjects that I want to cover. The fifth will be a brief briefing on the present political and military situation in the country, since I presume you would be interested in that. And it will not be just for me not to talk about it, since you expect it. And the last one will be the dialogue with you, and that will involve myself and the rest of the delegation. If we are agreed on that, since we are in a democratic world, I suppose we are agreed. Since we are agreed, therefore, let me begin. The problem, as much as you know, as you all know, Sudan has been at war within itself for 46 years of independence, and it's quite a common sense question to ask, why would any community subject itself to decades of war? In this decades of war, our people have been subjected to immense suffering. Generations have been lost to illiteracy. In the first war, no, it is now statistics, that is the Anyanya War, of which I was a member, it is estimated that between 750,000 and 1.5 million people died in that war. Now, in this war, people talk about 2 million people dying as a result of war and war-related causes. Human memory being what it is short. Nobody is, very few people are thinking anymore about the suffering and loss of lives in the first war. They are captured by the intensity of this war, which has already caused a lot of suffering. So why is this happening? In my view, the attempt by various cartoon-based regimes to build a monolithic Arab Islamic state to the exclusion of the other parameters of the Sudanese diversity constitutes the fundamental problem of the Sudan and defines the Sudanese conflict. There is war in the Sudan simply because the Arab Islamic state or Islamic Arab state that there is can only be imposed by force, and that logically leads to instability and war. It is not true. It contradicts reality that Sudan consists only of two primary factors, Arabism and Islamism. It's much more than that. And I'm not making this up. I'm not making it up. Even in your sitting here, you are different. We have Poor, we have Nuba, we have Dinkas, we have Dwes, we have Zandes, we have Dija, we have Ingasina, we have Arabs, we have, and among the Arabs we have the Bagara, we have the Reshaida, and the Reshaida incidentally are comrades in arms with me in Eastern Sudan. So you see, I'm not making it up, God made it. This is the reality of our country. They are all Sudan. This is its diversity. There are two forms of diversity that I can briefly allude to. Historical diversity. When you go through the corridors of history, you will find that the present geographical Sudan existed in various forms. Books of antiquity, including the Bible, talks about the Sudan, as Sudan, as Kush, and many of you have read Isaiah chapter 18 and many other verses of the Bible. But the Menza Mandak. Then you come to the ancient kingdoms of Wawat, of Irtet, of Majda, of Anu. There is a story that the ancient Egyptians, when they made sacrifices to their gods, one of these gods was the Anu. The god Anu controlled the waters, gave the water. Well, Egypt is the gift of the Nile, and the Nile is the gift of the Sudan. And so this god Anu was in the Sudan. And it will prevent this moya is as Alan. Now the gods are angry. Because of the war. This Anu in some historical references refers to the Anuak tribe. God Anu. Hasab al Tariq. It is connected with the Anuak. This is history. Again, I'm not making it up. The Mojud. Then you come to more recent times of Christian Nubia, Marawi, Makuria, Soba, down to the period after Christ, 300 AD, up to 1500, when these kingdoms collapsed and were superseded as a result of Arab migrations into the Sudan and the spread of Islam from the 17th century to the present. This is again Sudanese historical continuity. These kingdoms were superseded by the modern Islamic states of the Funj, of Darfur, and others, down to 1820 or thereabouts, when the Turco-Egyptian occupation of the Sudan happened or occurred, and a new period began, up to the Mahdist state in 1885 to 1998, down to the Anglo-Egyptian condominium of 1898 up to independence in 1956. And then you take the independence period from 1956 to the present. And maybe I will take also a special period of the NIF regime from 1989 to the present. Some people, when they think of the Sudan, depending on their bias, some start with the Sudan beginning in 1820, as if we were not there. We were there. The fact that I am here is a proof that I was there. I did not pop up from nowhere. The NIM would say that Sudan started in 1989. And some would say that Sudan started in 1956. My contention is that Sudan has already always been there. As we have seen in our long history, peoples and kingdoms have lived, thrived, and disappeared in the geographical area that constitutes the present modern Sudan. Of course, some people would argue that this is all rubbish. Nasdel Khan Mafeshin. It is an attempt, of course, to derail you from history. And if you don't have roots in history, then you are a nobody. Any struggle must be anchored in history. Our contention in the SPLM-SPL is that the Sudan belongs to all the peoples that now inhabit the country, and that its history, its diversity and richness is our common heritage and inheritance. Madikal Isul Tani lives in the borough. You are there. Filtaria. That is historic. This historical diversity defines the present Sudanese. Well, Amthal Fi, yani Muslim, if you take Sudanese music, Khasat in Fishumal, It is more akin to Eritrean and Ethiopian and Somali music than it is to Saudi Arabian music. I'm not making it up. And so it is fertilized by the various influences, Arab influences, African influences, all constituting and feeding into the present form of the Sudanese music, or Northern Sudanese music, and Southern Sudanese music, and Western Sudanese music. Kuludel, for those of you who have interests in culture, in music, you will agree with me. Now, let us then talk about contemporary diversity. Let me tell you. Lakin Halia. The second form of the Sudanese diversity is the contemporary diversity. Again, the Sudan has over 500 different ethnic groups, speaking more than 130 distinct languages. These ethnic groups fall roughly into what would be called indigenous African Sudanese and Arab Sudanese, people who came from, or people who are of Arab background. And when you look at this, at the statistics, according to the census of 1956, those who registered as Africans or African Sudanese were 69% of the population. Those who registered as Arab Sudanese were roughly 31% of the population. If you look in the north itself, you will find that the majority of the people, well, African Sudanese at that time in 1955-56 was defined in terms of language. Those who had Arabic as their community language, look at Al-Dum, when you are born, and the first language you speak as a community, were roughly 31% of the population. Those who had the indigenous African languages were 69% of the population. This is one form of diversity. It is ethnic diversity. And it is there. We should not shy away about talking about it. The Luwaga, the Mujud. The other form of diversity is religion. Roughly 65% of our population are Muslim. The remaining 35% of the population are either Christians or believe in traditional African religions. And so when we were discussing this morning how we should start, some people say, well, we start with prayer. So, okay, let us start with prayer. Muslim, Christian and Muslim. And then is a visual with the Kanyagir, the traditional African religion. It is good to be transparent about these things. And so, when some people talk about an Islamic majority, this is a very dangerous language, because nobody should be anybody's majority, and nobody should be anybody's minority. Article 1 of the NIF Constitution of the Sudan, the 1998 Constitution of the Sudan, Article 1, the beginning of the Constitution, talks about Muslims being the majority of the population of the Sudan. It is a fact.
But why put it in Article 1 of
the Why put it in the Constitution at all? Because it is elected. You could also talk about indigenous African majority as a dangerous concept. You could also talk about a women's majority, because women are the majority. So, Mr. NIF, if you want us to talk about majorities, we will talk about it. We'll talk about the women's majority, and I would ask the women to go in the streets and demonstrate to take over so that the majority rules. If it is the dictatorship of the majority, then it will. Let us not talk about somebody's majority and somebody's minority. There's already injustice being built into the Constitution. And so, in summary, let me define the Sudan. I have a mathematical definition of the Sudan. What happened?
problem.
Then I'm going to have a problem with the others. For the coffee machine?
Okay. Who are mathematically inclined? We can define the Sudan mathematically as a function of three variables. S stands for the Sudan. F means the function of the variables in the brackets. X being an array, Xi to Xn, representing historical diversity. فممكن تخشش أي حاجة in our history في كولومبتر X. Y is an array, Yi to Yn, representing contemporary diversity. What is the present forms of diversity? While Z or Z is an array Zi to Zn, representing other human and environmental influences impacting on the Sudan. For the NIF and previous governments to Khartoum, Sudan is a function only of two variables, Arabism and Islam. The مشكلة. We need to solve that.
You see, I'm from the bush.
I have a point with my
Mr. Chairman, you are not from the bush, you are from the front line.
Well, this is the problem with our Sudan. The definition of the Sudan, in my view, what is objectively true, means Sita Wakamsi, has been exclusive. It has excluded others. And when you exclude others, they will fight back. And that is what has happened, the exclusion of others. What is the SPLM response to this situation? The SPLM was formed in 1983 to address the fundamental problem of the Sudan. And the vision and objectives of the SPLM are based on this paradigm. We have articulated the objectives of the SPLM, SPLA, in global terms as the abolition of what we have called the double apartheid political system of the Sudan, an establishment of a new Sudan, a new Sudanese political dispensation that is based on the Sudanese reality as defined in the general mathematical equation of X, Y, Z, instead of only two parameters of Arabism and Islamism. Arabism, or the Arab culture, and Islam are important parameters of our reality, which we freely admit. But there are other parameters in the Sudanese equation which must be included for us to have a correct form of unity and to have peace in our country. And we have become so much conditioned. And when somebody says a Sudan Dola Arabia, it appears normal. Lakin, if I were to say that a Sudan Lazim Okun Dola for Awiya, of course the fool should be happy with me. لكن بقول زول ده مجنون شيلو مستشفى هو عيان. But when somebody says the Sudan dola Arabia, they don't say take you to the hospital. It appears normal. It is not normal. It is wrong. And so, what are the objectives of the SPLM, SPLA? I'll define them as consisting of three interrelated outcomes to the struggle. One, somebody has gone to put this in a transparency. But when it comes, I'll give an illustration. But one outcome, or one objective of the Haraka, is immediate achievement of the new Sudan. This is Sudan, the new Sudan as defined as belonging to all of us. It means a quantum leap, a movement from the existing Sudan, an Islamic Arab Sudan, to the new Sudan, Bitana Kuluna. This entails the immediate abolition of the existing situation and the immediate and complete restructuring of the Sudan. You are welcome to discuss what this means in concrete terms. Interpam Shekhev, how do you move from the present situation of a Sudan that has cost us 36 years of war out of 46 years of our independence? Let us agree that we cannot maintain this form of Sudan. It has already cost us 36 years of war. How many more years of war do we want to cost us to maintain it? This kind of Sudan is unmaintainable. It is untenable. It must go. We are going to fit Howell, Carmen, in a Sudan al-Qadim of injustice, of suffering, of instability, of wars, to a new Sudan. That when I come to Khartoum, and I'm going to fit in Sudan, Aqib, as a Sinarang, Umahaba Kaman fil Jama. And whenever I go, one time I traveled from Cuba to Khartoum, Uzamili Aqib Zahid, ask me, girl, I don't need to get to Sudan with him. This is a true story. I don't want to mention his name. But he knows himself. Doesn't mean girl need to get to Sudan with him. And I had just come from Cuba. That Sudan is unmaintainable. So that's one objective. Vital Harakat. I have conceptualized this in the form of Venn diagrams in models. I'll show them shortly. That's one objective. If we can succeed in doing this, a complete overhaul, which engine with Arabia can do a Batal Khalis, which we have to overhaul, for Sudan, I will overhaul. We are going to see complete transformation. If this can be done, that would be best. However, if this cannot be done, the only way, of course, in which it can be done is for there to be complete separation, constitutional separation of religion and state. Because you cannot have a just Sudan within a theocratic state. But in all the peace talks that we have held with the regime in Khartoum, the regime in Khartoum has consistently argued that ma'amunkin, they cannot separate religion and state. They say it is in the nature of their religion. I say fine. Then let us establish a Sudanese confederation as a form of unity, where those who want religion and state to be combined can have their state. And the rest of us who would want to respect religion that's been separated from the state have another state. And still there will be free movement of people, goods and services within that kind of arrangement. It's a realistic model that is short of the new Sudan. Mabel have a new Sudan. And that is short of independence for the component parts of the country. But it's a model that can end the war. So that we can put our lives together and still work for the new Sudan. Or work for the alternative outcome of independence for the component parts if a new Sudan is untenable. It's a realistic model. We have been criticized for it by people who religiously worship a united Sudan. Why would I be interested in a united Sudan that discriminates me? No, it's not religion. Nobody would stay in a situation that discriminates him or her. And so the second objective of establishment of a Sudanese confederation is a necessity imposed by the intransigence of those who want to have their cake and eat it at the same time. They want the unity of the country and they want an Islamic State. These are mutually exclusive. You cannot have a united Sudan and an Islamic constitution. They don't go together. The third objective is the exercise of the right of self-determination. The interim period, which is model two in my Venn diagrams, is followed by an internationally supervised referendum on self-determination to choose between two options. Continuation of the Confederate Union and its improvement, or two, full independence for the component parts of the country. Now that is also an option. For at the end of the interim period, people will decide whether this form of unity, and we have presented all this in all our negotiations with the government in Khartoum. We have said that you accept constitutional separation of religion and state. If you don't accept this, then let us agree that we have fundamentally disagreed on this issue. So that we call this disagreement, we call it an agreement. Because you cannot base a political agreement on a disagreement. We've got to find an agreement. And so on the issue of religion and state, if we cannot separate the two and respect the two, respect all religions, then let us agree that we have fundamentally disagreed. It's a simple thing. In the Western world here, it is called living together without getting married. we propose not marriage, but living together. The subject of negotiations then would be how to live together during the interim period. At the end of the interim period, we will decide whether to continue this form of union or complete an effective divorce. Unfortunately, I don't have my Venn diagrams, but I have tried to explain what I have depicted in the Venn diagrams. In the Venn diagrams, I have five models. Model one is an Islamic Arab state. This is the existing situation now. This is model three. Model four is a hypothetical model of a secular indigenous African Sudan, because if the Arabs in the Sudan can claim to have a state, there's no reason why the Africans also cannot claim to have a Sudan of their own. So it is a hypothetical situation, but not far-fetched. So those are model three and model four. These two models, model three, an Islamic Arab state, and model four, an indigenous African state, are inherently unjust, unstable, and lead to war. Because in the first model, model three, of an Islamic Arab state, the non-Arab will resist and establish their own state. And if the Africans take over, the Arab will resist and establish their own state. So let us drop these two models. They don't work, they cannot work. Model two is what we have called the Confederate model. It is an intermediate model where you are unable to go to the new Sudan. That's model one. Okay, I've been informed that there is no transparent photocopy. And model five is the complete independence model. Now, I want to emphasize that all these options are not there for the given. Nobody gives them. You got to struggle for them. whether it is the new Sudan you want, that is a completely restructured Sudan, you got to struggle for it. Whether it is the Confederate intermediate arrangement which you want, you got to struggle for it. If it is the Islamic Arab state you want, well, it is already there, it is the existing one. And it is there by force. Whether it is the independence you want, you got to struggle for it. So all these options are not available at no cost. They must entail a struggle. So let me come back to the vision of the new Sudan as a method of struggle. We have presented this vision as both a strategy method of a struggle. It is said that a person without vision gropes in the dark. This is of course literally true of a blind man or woman. It is also true for a liberation movement. A liberation movement must have a clear vision, clear objectives, and concrete strategies, programs, and tactics for achieving those objectives. These concepts are interrelated, and sometimes the dividing line between vision, strategy, and tactics is very thin. This is why some people get confused between the new Sudan as a vision and as a method of a struggle, because it combines all these aspects, i.e. it is a vision, it is an objective, and it is a method of a struggle. It is important in this context to appreciate the difference, a relation between the global long-term objective of the new Sudan and the particular short-term objective of confederation and self-determination leading to a continued confederate union and its development into the new Sudan or independence. It is also important to appreciate the concept of the new Sudan as a vision, as well as a vision, as well as a method of a struggle for achieving self-determination that leads either to the new Sudan or to independence. I have already talked about the new Sudan as a vision, and so I would like to cover here the new Sudan as a method for achieving peace and self-determination. So let me come down to earth from the theoretical to the practical. In the peace process, we have articulated three tracks. Talata Mahwi. Three tracks for achieving peace and self-determination. Track one is negotiations with the achieving peace and self-determination through negotiations with the government of the day. Track two is the modality of the NDA. Track three is peace through development. I would briefly elaborate on these three. Track one, negotiations with the government of the day. This is what we have been doing all the time in Abuja 1, Abuja 2, now in IGAD, in the Libyan-Egyptian initiative, or Egyptian-Libyan initiative, it depends where you are. If you are in Tripoli, it is Libyan-Egyptian initiative, and if you are in Egypt, it is Egyptian-Libyan initiative. In any case, it is the same initiative. All this is track one, trying to achieve peace through a negotiated political settlement. Under this track, we have the outstanding issues on this track are four. We have the issue of religion and state. There's no agreement on this. Some people on this issue of religion and state will say that don't let us concentrate too much. It's okay. Let us not concentrate on the issue of religion and state. Let us postpone this until the exercise of the right of self-determination. And we say no. Life will not be frozen during the interim period. the outcome of the exercise of the right of self-determination in a referendum will actually depend on the form of governance during the interim period. And so we cannot postpone resolution of the issue of religion and state pending that time when you will exercise your right of self-determination, whenever it is. And so we say from day one, at the beginning of the interim period, and when should Lazim Hillu? Well, Halbidana Day of Confederalia. It is an immediate response to the insistence of the NIF that the state and religion cannot be separated. You say, fine, then you have them in your constitution. That's, of course, unfair to some people in the north who do not want the religion and the state in the constitution. That's fine. I stand in solidarity with that view. But I will not be in the forefront. And I'm not going to be firing like the Mokadima. And so, that is one issue that is relevant, and that on which we have not agreed on track one, religion and state. The second point of disagreement on track one, negotiated political settlement, the haqqa al-masir, the right of self-determination. Although all sides give lip service to this issue, the government has signed the DOP of IGAD, we have signed it. Each side has a different interpretation of haqqa al-masir or the right of self-determination. To the government in Khartoum, they mean that Southerners are free to choose how to manage themselves, but within the parameters of an Islamic state. No other. For us, it means choice between union, some form of union, like the Confederate Union, and the outcome of complete and total independence for the component parts of the country. But there is no agreement on that. The third issue on the negotiated political settlement is the issue of governance during the interim period. Hukumat Khartoum, they think that they will be the government during the interim period. This cannot be. There must be a transitional government that includes all the parties, and in which the NIF is not necessarily the captain of the team. Well, that is an outstanding issue. The fourth outstanding issue is the issue of Abyei. It's a district in Kordofan where the Ngok Dinka are, and which is administratively part of Kordofan. Musir Umshunufi Haktagiri Musir. The other areas in which the SPLA is, that is in the Nuba Mountains and in southern Blue Nile. How do you handle these three areas? These are four issues that are unresolved on the first track, a negotiated political settlement. We will continue to negotiate on this track. But if we don't agree, if we don't reach a political settlement through a negotiated political arrangement, then what do we do? That brings me to track two. That is the NDA modality. To achieve peace and self-determination through the modality of the NDA, the National Democratic Alliance. And this is important. National Democratic Alliance in 1995 was rejuvenated. We issued the Asmara Declaration. And we are pursuing this track, track two, without prejudice to track one, without prejudice to negotiations. So the aim of the NDA in the Asmara Declaration of 1995 is removal of the NIF regime and its replacement by the government of the NDA. Some people say that we should negotiate with the NIF in the NDA. We have no problem with that, we are negotiating. But I believe that in the modality of the NDA, the NIF is too deformed to be reformed. It must be removed. It is difficult for the SPLA, having its base in the south, to have the objective of removing the NIF without the rest of the Sudanese political forces. But if you bring the rest of the Sudanese political forces together with the SPLM, SPLA, then there is no argument that the NIF should be negotiated with. Through the NDA, the NIF lazim yumshi. And so we are doing everything in the NDA to bring all the political forces together. We have, for example, met twice and agreed with the Popular National Congress, Mu'tamar al-Sha'bi, with Dr. Hassan al-Turabi. Some of you may say, but this whole desert, we are all... This old desert, we lakin. If you are going to have a new Sudan on the NDA track, it is our principal position in the movement that we must engage all the political forces in dialogue. Including the party of Dr. Hassan al-Turab. Because if you take, well, let us take negotiations with Bashir, the government in Khartoum, you will agree with me that the NIF of Dr. Hassan al-Turabi and the NIF of Dr. Bashir are aspects of the same movement. The facile with Nafs al-Haraka. Why would I justify negotiating with Bashir in IGAD, in the Egyptian Libyan Initiative, and I have problems negotiating or having dialogue with Dr. Hassan al-Turabi? I cannot reconcile that contradiction in my mind. Is that the Nafs al-Haraka? As a matter of fact, the faction of Bashir is more dangerous to me as a freedom fighter than the faction of Dr. Hassan al-Turabi, because the faction of Bashir controls the apparatus of the state. They control the army, they control the security services. They are the ones killing me. Yet I negotiate with them. So, it is incumbent on me to negotiate with both aspects of the NIF, the one in power and the one out of power. And if we can have dialogue with the ideologues, much the better. Because I would want somebody to convince me how Sudan can remain united under an Islamic constitution. And the best people who could do this are the people who have the ideology. And so, dialogue with the PNC, in my view, is necessary and is useful. And we have been engaged with them, with the party of Dr. Hassan al-Turabi, and we will continue to engage them in dialogue. And if it becomes feasible to have alliance with them against the present regime, so be it, so that we continue to dialogue and work together, not only with them, but with all the political forces in the NDA, so as to bring down this regime and then sit down to agree on how to rule our country and on the new Sudanese political dispensation. On this same basis, we have also recently agreed and united with the Sudan Alliance Forces of Brigadier Abdulaziz Khalid. So the NDA is becoming stronger and stronger. We are collecting all the Sudanese political forces so that you have the regime on one side and you have the opposition on one side. We are Kunma Bilakba Dafinus. So that's the modality of the NDA. We met in Massawa in the year 2000. We agreed on the charter of the new Sudan. And so through the modality of the NDA, you can achieve peace by removing the NIF regime, putting in its place a government of the NDA and exercising the right of self-determination at the end of the interim period. Now, in terms of track 3, you can see how this can be done. You can, for example, well, I have, say, a program for the activation of the NDA, and we have been doing this since the Massawa Declaration in the year 2000. Achieving peace through track 3 by developing track 2 by developing the NDA. One is to consolidate the NDA itself so that we transform the NDA into a true and genuine vehicle for the achievement of the objectives of the New Sudan. So we transform that umbrella and the component parts of the NDA, particularly the DUP, are working on this. The DUP is a member, is a major party in the NDA. They are committed to the Charter for the New Sudan in Massawa and in all the NDA meetings. The other political forces also in the Tejama will redouble their efforts in order to consolidate this structure and build it into a viable alternative for the NIF regime, something that Dr. Yagmachia talked about before. I'm convinced that the modality of the NDA, they are overdeed the Hukuma al-Jabah al-Islamiyya. People are agreed that Lazim couldn't be changed in Sudan, especially after September 11th events. And the NIF took advantage of this of these events to run after the after the Americans with the information about terrorism. After me to me Mullah files. Ubegi do warang piha jaka ni tu. And only yesterday, America was the big devil in their eyes. The Kulu media before. Now, bigger Halif. Now they are allies against international terrorism. Shiva wants a bit. So the NIF is trying to do the unthinkable. They are trying to present themselves as the alternative to themselves. This is precisely what they are doing. They must not be allowed to get away with this. Into that kind of organization that is seen by the Sudanese people and seen by the international community to be the real and true alternative to the NIF regime. And that's the challenge, lekum, to all the Sudanese, inside the Sudan and in the diaspora. And in an organization called the NDA that has the potential to be built into an alternative for the NIF regime. So what is it that we need to do? One, I have said that we need the political structure itself, the NDA, to be transformed into this vehicle for achievement of the New Sudan. And I call upon you, those who are in diaspora here and elsewhere, to organize yourselves into NDA. Ashan Tesaham. So that you contribute to its to the program of the NDA. To go beyond the NDA as an arithmetic sum of its component parts, DUP plus SPLM plus Communist Party plus Video Congress, that's an arithmetic sum. We want to transform the NDA to become an organic movement for the New Sudan. No other organization can do it. SPLM, Mabior, Barawa, Bukulda, Harga, Junubia. The DUP will not do it alone. The Communist Party will not do it alone. The B.Tech Congress will not do it alone. SAF will not do it alone. And so the agreement that we have just signed with SAF is a milestone because it helps in the consolidation of the NDA into an organic movement for the new Sudan. And some of you here and elsewhere can contribute to it. Further, that's one program that we need to work on. And it needs your contribution. It needs your contribution intellectual. It needs your contribution material. All these are possible if we become one organizational entity called the NDA. Second thing we will do and we are doing is to form an army of the NDA. And so we are putting all our military forces, the SPLM and other FASAI, we are putting them into one army so that there is a unified military command for the NDA. Because we are not going to go to Khartoum with seven or eight flags. The Bakun flag wahid with the NDA and an NDA army. That we are doing and will continue to do. A third program we are doing is establishment of civil authority in the liberated areas as a nucleus for the formation of the new Sudan. That one we are also doing. We are establishing civil authority for the new Sudan, Fulmanatul al-Muharara. And you are welcome, I'll talk about this shortly, peace through development, that is track three. But you are welcome to contribute to the development of our liberated areas. But I'm talking in the context of the NDA. The fourth element, the fourth program of the NDA is development of the Intifada in Khartoum and other cities. The fifth program is convergence of the Intifada with the NDA unified army to bring about a decisive outcome in Khartoum leading to the new Sudan. The sixth is the establishment of an interim transitional government of the NDA for the new Sudan to implement the transitional program, conduct the referendum on self-determination, and subsequently hold general elections. Finally, seventh program of the NDA is formation of a new army of the new Sudan, formed from units of the NDA Unified Army, the SPLA, and non-NIF elements of the present Sudanese army. They will make my into one army, an army for the new Sudan. Because if you are going to have a new Sudan, you must have an army that is consistent with the character of the new Sudan. If you are going to have an Islamic state, you must have an army that is consistent with the character of the Islamic state. And that is exactly what the NIF has been doing since 1989. The destruction of the Sudanese army and its replacement by the army of the NIF. And in a way, ironically, we have been allies with the NIF in doing this. The SPLA has been destroying the Sudanese army. The NIF has been destroying the Sudanese army. Not by agreement, by default. But what I'm saying here is that the Jeshi Sudanese, there are patriotic elements. Actually, the majority of the Sudanese army are patriotic elements, despite what the NIF has been doing over the last 13 years. For nine of the NDA, with the SPLM, SPLA, with the Jeshi Sudanese, let us find a working modality where we come together to constitute one army for the new Sudan. Finally, is achieving peace through track three. What are we saying on this? We are saying that if you cannot achieve peace and self-determination through track one, that is, you cannot achieve peace through a negotiated political settlement, the regime simply refuses to make any concession, especially on the issue of religion and state, then what do we do? We must remove this regime through track two, by the modality of the NDA. But if that does not also work, what do you do? This is where we have evolved the issue of track three, peace through development. And what we are saying here is that as you liberate areas, establish a civil administration, establish law and order, have peace and stability through the civil structures, and start development. Don't wait for a political agreement on track one or on track two. So is either the EA, Muslim, or the Kajikeji, with them another Muharram. Then you have achieved already your self-determination. Why do you want it to be approved by Patu? If you are in Meridi, you have achieved self-determination. If you are in Rumbek, you have achieved self-determination. In the Muntasar, do what you need to do in that area, in terms of socio-economic development. And that's precisely what we are doing. So in all our areas, the liberated areas, with the SBLM, SBLA, we have started development in earnest. It requires doing a lot of things. It requires reorganization of the SBLM leadership and military fronts as by way of ensuring collective and more compact leadership in the conduct of the liberation struggle. That's one. It requires full activation of the SBLM secretariat to establish SBLM structures at all levels, from the village to the national, and ending in our second SBLM national convention, which we hope to hold this year. It requires the creation of organic units of the SPLA into fronts and transforming the SPLA into an organic army of the New Sudan so that it converges with other armed elements of the NDA. It requires the consolidation of civil authority of the New Sudan, an active encouragement of the growth of civil society and civil society institutions, all engaged in the liberation struggle in various ways. It requires the restoring the legitimacy and authority of our people over the relief structures through the memorandum of understanding which we have signed with various NGOs. It requires the creation of our own currency, the currency for the New Sudan, Gurusha. Because you cannot develop a modern economy between Gurush. Money is like the lubricant of a locomotive with respect to the economy. And so we are going ahead with the production of the New Sudan town. That will include establishment of a central bank, commercial bank, financial institutions, crops bureaus, and so forth. Others are doing it. Somalia, mind you, Mahakuma, Markezia, Latina, I don't do it. We have had problems, of course, printing money, but we have resolved that. It requires, of course, establishment of radio SPLA so that our message is out and our people know about it. Radio SPLA is a man Khan Shakal Khalis, who can very popular, and it carried out our message. I assure you that before our next anniversary, the radio SPLA will be working again. It requires promotion of peace, grassroots peace and reconciliation among our people, and dialogue with all the political groups in the country. And that is precisely what we are doing. And as you have seen, my brother, Dr. Yak Machar, in the SPLM delegation here, is a sign of that unity. And we'll continue to bring all the various political forces and individuals together. Now, the year 2002, we have declared it as a year of peace, unity, and reconciliation. And I'm ready to meet anybody, any group, anytime, any place. In terms of what we have done so far on track three, and what we need to do, we need an efficient network of roads so that our people can move, goods and services can move. I was traveling from Kampala to Rumbek recently to meet the Minister Claire Short, and it took me 30 hours. From Kampala to Kaya on the border, it took me 10 hours. It is 516 kilometers. But from Kaya to Rumbek, It took me 20 hours. It is 575 kilometers. It's almost the same distance, double the time. That's because of the badness of the road. So we need to maintain our roads, construct new roads and maintain the old ones. Construction of a telecommunications network to link the various regions and counties of the New Sudan. It requires investment. You are welcome to go and invest. It requires self-reliance in terms of food and encouragement of trade and investment in the liberated areas and in neighboring countries. It requires exports of our products such as gum, arabic, and oil seeds. And we are doing this. We are now advertising ourselves in the internet as the biggest organic farm in the world. And indeed we are. We guarantee that any sesame seeds you buy from the New Sudan will be pesticide free, will be fertilizer free, no modified foods, no mad cow disease. It requires institutional building and human resource development on the correct basis. And so we are now in the liberated areas running more than 3,000 primary schools. We have at least 16 senior secondary schools. Rumbe Senior Secondary School is functioning full blast. I visited it recently. So under the supervision of the senior secondary schools, we have just end of last year established our first university level college. It's an institute, it is called IDEAS. It will Institute for Development, Environmental and Agricultural Studies. It will give from short courses of 2 weeks or 3 months or 6 months for immediate needs like agricultural extension workers and so forth, teachers for primary schools that need to have refresher training. From these short courses all the way to university level education. So we are taking our first students this year that will start first year, and hopefully in 4 years' time we will have our first graduates from the New Sudan. And so you are welcome to contribute to this nation building by whatever you do here, or by going back home to contribute in whatever way, even through private business, through investments. This was the Zanderland 2 years ago, who made after $80,000 from agriculture by producing surplus grain, which was bought by NGOs for deficit areas in Bahrain. And so this thing is going on. Schools are being built, hospitals are being built, and on a community level basis, organizations are springing up that are providing these social services. It requires the organization of our people abroad in diaspora for effective contribution in all these fields. And so I make this appeal to you to contribute in whatever ways that are within your possibilities. I would like to conclude this section of peace through development by emphasizing again the role of the youth, to whom the future belongs. The youth should organize and rally behind the third track, and we are doing this internally inside our country by encouraging youth organizations, encouraging women's organizations. And these are important segments of our population, the women and youth, contributing to development, both on the third track and on the second track of the NDA. And so I appeal for your membership, either directly as a member of the NDA or through an organization, political organization that belongs to the NDA, like the SPLM and the SAF, which are now one. We should work to improve our organizational forms among you here in the diaspora. And the contribution will be great. especially to our Eastern Front, which is the NDA front. Finally, I've taken a lot of time. I said before that this was going to be a dialogue. I'm afraid it is turning into a monologue. I'm sorry. And so let me quickly summarize. In terms of the military and political situation, which is the last subject matter I talked about before, in terms of the political situation, in the form of briefing, the biggest development that is influencing or impacting on the Sudanese political situation, I believe, is the September 11th events in New York and Washington. As I said before, the regime is trying to use this in order to be to transform itself into an alternative to itself, and this must be prevented by building the NDA, and that is what we have been doing in the recent meetings of the NDA in Asmara, in which we reassured ourselves that the NDA is the only vehicle that can lead to peace in the country, a comprehensive and just peace, and that will include all the political forces in the country. The other issues, I've already talked about them. Our agreement with the SPDF of Dr. Riek Machar, who is here, this will consolidate our unity. Our agreement with the Sudan Alliance Forces of Abdullah Muqatil Abdulaziz Khalid would also consolidate the unity of the NDA. Our agreement with the PNC of Turabi, some of you may not agree with me on this, but it will increase dialogue among the political forces in the country. The final issue is the military situation. Despite what the propaganda of the NIF, I want to assure you that all our military fronts behave. There has been, for the last, since 1997, when we went on a major offensive, there has been no major reverse in our military fortunes, except for Western Bahr al-Ghazal, that is Raja, and which is an objective which we took and lost. That is in the nature of war. War consists of battles lost and battles won. But that does not mean a loss of the war. We only took Raja in June. We lost it in October. Just like Kurmuk, we lost Kurmuk twice, and we took it three times. So not only Kurmuk and Raja, the situation is such that the modality of the NDA, I believe, and I assure you, will work. The combination between Itifada, the Khartoum, and Mudun al-Ukhra, my unified military command of the NDA, is a modality about which the NDA can do very little, about which the NIF can do very little. The NIF, when they came to power in 1989, analyzed the situation and identified the threats to their rule. One threat was the SPLA, second threat is the Intifada, the third threat is the Sudanese army, because Mahabub. And so the NIF systematically worked to destroy these three. Of course, the forces of the Intifada are the trade union movement, the youth movement, the women movement, and the NIF worked to destabilize these structures. They also worked to destabilize the SPLM, SPLA, and they literally destroyed the Sudanese army. And so the NIF knew how to respond to threats against it, given its very vast experience since the 60s and the 50s. But there is a combination, and I have no problem saying this, they can hear it. There is a combination about which they can do nothing. The convergence between the forces of the Intifada and the forces of the armed struggle in the modality of the NDA, there is nothing the NIF can do about this. And I'm sure that combination will eventually bring the NIF down and usher our country in a new era. This is the last part of my presentation, and I would then move to our dialogue. And so without much ado, let me summarize the before I give you the floor, in terms of the roadmap from vision to achievement of our objectives, I have argued that the vision of the movement is correct. There is no shortcut to freedom. The New Sudan is the most viable method for achieving self-determination through a three-track approach. That is, self-determination can be achieved through a negotiated political settlement, that is track one. It can be achieved through the modality of the NDA, that is track two. It can be achieved endogenously through peace through development, that is track three. And I leave you with the challenge that if anybody has another track, if you have track four, I'll be willing to discuss this with you. But I believe we are on track. The movement is on track with self-determination on these three tracks. There are examples. Example of the Polisario, for example. Now, self-determination can also is a double-edged sword. You can use it to achieve your objective, whether it is the Confederation or the New Sudan you want, or an independent Southern Sudan you want, you can achieve it through self-determination. It can be used also against you, actually to destroy self-determination. That's exactly what the King of Morocco did with respect to the Polisario. With the Polisario, the issue of self-determination was very advanced. There's a Security Council resolution on self-determination. The Sahara Arab Republic was even recognized by the OAU. So the King of Morocco, instead of swimming against the current of self-determination, swam with it in order to destroy it from within. And so they smuggled a lot of... The best way to achieve the objective of self-determination, and self-determination, by the way, does not necessarily lead to independence. That's a mistake many people make. They say, we want self-determination so that we have an independent Southern Sudan. That's a tautological nonsense. Why would you want self-determination that leads to independence? Self-determination can lead either to independence or to a union. That's the meaning of self-determination. Otherwise, it is no longer self-determination. But can it house independence? But who can house self-determination? Who can it house independence? And of course, you fight it out. But if we are to be logically consistent, self-determination, you must allow that self-determination mungkin to lead towards an independent Southern Sudan, or an independent Darfur, for that matter. It doesn't have to be Southern Sudan. I was reading the literature of some movement in Darfur the other day, and they were calling for an independent state in Darfur. The Sultanate of the Masali. Can andu mitafagia ma British or French. Long time ago during the colonial period. And that agreement has just expired. And so the Masali are going to the international court to plead and to argue with the British and the French that agreement you have intact. So you can have an independent state in Darfur as well. That can also be achieved through this, the right of self-determination. So the movement is on track, on all the three tracks. And I ask you to contribute in any track you are comfortable with. Can under good reason to contribute on track one, we ask for your contribution. Under Gutre to contribute on track two, we ask for your contribution. Under Gutre to contribute on track three, we ask for your contribution. At the end of the day, I assure you that the SPLM, SPLA will continue the struggle until the objectives of our people are achieved. Thank you very much.